As one of the world's youngest leaders, Finland's Prime Minister is leading her country at a critical historical juncture. Sanna Marin was in New Zealand as part of a trade delegation this week, and she and I sat down in Auckland.
Prime Minister, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much for having me.
I want to begin with the situation in Ukraine. Finland shares more than 1,000 kilometres of border with Russia. And recently you've announced a strengthening of the border fence and some of the infrastructure at the border. What is the threat you're trying to protect against?
Well, it's to do with the border control and the border surveillance. We have had very good cooperation actually with the Russian border control so far, but because of the situation in Ukraine and also the future, we have to make sure that also in the future we have border secure control that we will need. So we are building a fence and also the surveillance system that comes with it, so that we can make sure that also in the future our borders are secure in every situation. It's not to do with defense, it's to do with border control, that we will be able to control the border in different kind of situations.
Are you worried about Russians illegally entering Finland?
Well, of course we share a border and there is people moving across the border every day. We have tightened the visas that we are now giving. So only if you have family members or specific reason to enter Finland you are able. But no tourist visas is no more submitted to Russian citizens because of the war in Ukraine. It's not right that Russian citizens can be tourists in Europe while Russian military forces are killing civilians in Ukraine.
Does that mean that Russians who want to avoid military conscription can't enter Finland?
Well, if you have a reason that is listed in our decisions, then you can enter, but there is also restrictions that we haven't had before, and I think also that it's very important that we would share the same rules in European standards and European level, because we are also talking about Schengen visas. So you cannot enter Finnish border to go somewhere else, but we are together in the Schengen system, so we need common rules as well.
Wouldn't it assist the Ukrainians if Finland were to take Russian men of a military age who want to escape Russia?
Well, of course, if you are people that think differently, for example, you are persecuted in Russia because you don't want to engage to the war or you think differently than the administration there, then you are able to seek refugee from Europe, for example, or enter. We have the list of reasons why you can come, and of course we want to make sure, for example, that media personnel or people that think differently that are under threat in Russia, that they can also enter. But the thing that you are referring, that we would take certain age men to Finland, that they wouldn't participate in the war. No, we don't want that kind of people entering Finland, because we also know that Russia is actually using Russian people as a tool to engage in other countries. So if you have a lot of Russian people in your country, then Russia is saying in their foreign policy that they want to protect their own citizens, and then they have the right to do different things. So I think it also opposes a foreign policy threat if you have a lot of Russian citizens in your soil.
In a worst case scenario, what would happen if Finland was drawn into conflict with Russia?
Well, I don't think that we should discuss about Finland. We should discuss about Ukraine. The war is in Ukraine. Civilians are killed in Ukraine. And we, as Finnish people, as European citizens, as democratic countries, we have to help. We have to help them. We don't need to look ourselves. We need to look at Ukraine and make sure that they will win, because the war is in Ukraine and people are killed every day in Ukraine. And there are also different kind of war crimes committed in Ukraine, brutal, brutal war crimes. So we are not focusing ourselves, we are focusing on Ukraine. And I think it also benefits us to make sure that Ukraine will win the war, and preferably sooner than later. Because if Ukraine won't win, if Russia thinks it won the war somehow, then it will only look different ways. I think they will gauge to Moldova, the Western Balkans, maybe even the Baltic countries, and then we would be in war in every decade. So I think the Russian mentality is showing its face now, that actually it thinks that they have the right to enter another country's soil to commit these brutal war crimes and do what they want. And we have to make sure that they will lose.
The answer to this may be obvious. Do you trust Vladimir Putin?
As a leader he is now, no, I don't trust him. I don't trust the Russian Federation. They are against all the international treaties that they have themselves signed. So no, they are not acting by the treaties that they are committed to. So we don't trust their actions right now, no.
Do you trust Vladimir Putin not to use nuclear weapons?
I think there is this kind of vague nuclear threat over Europe. We don't think that they would use nuclear weapons, not strategic nuclear weapons, for example, but we cannot be certain that there won't be this kind of threat. But of course, that would only escalate the situation. That would be very, very severe. And of course, there would be actions from different sides as well. But we all have to hope that it doesn't come to that, but there would be some reason in Russia that they wouldn't use these kind of weapons that would be devastating for everyone.
How do you think the war will end?
Well, I hope the war will end soon, and I hope the war will end Russian troops sending out of Ukraine, that Ukraine will win all the territories that are now under Russian control. But the main issue is, of course, the Ukrainians themselves to setting the rules and the basis for for peace. So we have to support Ukraine for the peace. They have to decide themselves, and we have to support what is their decision.
That's how you hope the war will end, but how do you think the war will end?
I think it will win. The Ukrainians win.
Let's talk about New Zealand. You're in New Zealand as part of a business delegation, and as I'm sure you're aware, our biggest export is agricultural commodities. When we think of Finland, we think of the likes of Nokia. If New Zealand wants to become a higher earning exporter with more sustainable exports in the future, what would be your advice?
I think it's very important to invest in research, development and innovation. We are actually now sharing a goal together with also opposition parties to raise our R&D investments to 4% to 2030. So that's very high ambitious goal, and we are sharing that also with the private sector. And actually the government will only provide 1/3 of the investment funds, and 2/3 will come from the private sector. So we are now looking towards the future and making sure that we are using enough money to research, development, innovation, new technologies where we can also gain the export income in the future.
You have warned about democracies over-reliance on trading relationships with countries that have autocratic regimes. New Zealand's largest trading partner is China. Do you think New Zealand needs to reassess its trading priorities?
I think everyone does. We will see in the future that technologies and the digital environment will only be more in our societies than now. And we have to make sure that we don't have that kind of dependencies that becomes vulnerabilities and risks that will come to realize. So we have to make sure that we have different trading routes, that we have democratic partners that we trade with, that we have the capabilities to produce, for example, semiconductors, chips, all the critical infrastructure that we need in our digital societies. So we cannot be dependent on authoritarian regimes, and we have to also learn from the current crisis, the current war in Europe. We are, as Europeans, we are too dependent on Russian energy, and we cannot be as dependent on new technologies and the digital infrastructure when it comes to authoritarian countries. We cannot be that vulnerable. We have to have our own strengths, our own know-how, our own knowledge, and our own production and the trading routes between democratic countries and partners.
Finally then, internationally, you are best known as being one of the youngest leaders on the world stage, probably the best answer as well. Do you feel like at times you have been held to a different standard to other leaders?
Well, of course, I think there are double standards in societies. We know that's a reality for many women, also many people from different backgrounds. I think it's very important that we have people from different backgrounds, different genders, different age, different generations, in the same decision-making table. I think that's the only way to make sure that all the angles are taking part of when you're making decisions. I think the decisions are better when it's made together with different kind of people.
Prime Minister, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much.